In between the class, we will have some discussions about NTSC, about IIT. Okay, so first let's start it. So our today's chapter is what? Today's topic is metals and non-metals. Of course, metalloids will also be there. Oh. I think I have to join through my phone as well. Yeah, so this is how our periodic table, we all are very well aware of that, right? Okay, so first thing we will see occurrence of metals and non-metals. Okay, you know, total we have 118 elements, right? But out of that, 92 or 94, we have only naturally occurring elements. Okay, 92 or 94, we have naturally occurring elements. What does it mean by naturally? Actually, it should be 94. Why? What is the meaning of naturally occurring elements? Yes, Aryan. Yeah, Aryan, I saw that. Okay. 94 naturally occurring elements means what? It's simple, bhai. That means naturally occurring elements, that means they are available in the earth, right? Maybe in the earth crust. Right? Or in the earth environment. Okay. Yes. Good, Surya. Correct. Out of them, 70 are metals, 22 are non-metals. Right? Yes. Some elements are shown in the both properties of metals and non-metals. And we know very well that those are known as metalloids. I am not able to see your chat. One second. What's happening? Just give me a minute, okay? I'll just log in through my phone as well. Yes, coming back to the point. Okay, yes. So only some of the metals like silver, gold, platinum, they are available in the free state. They are available in the free state. Why they are available in the free state? Because obviously we know very, very well that they are least reactive. Okay. Nice, Surya. Congrats. The first pre-board is done. Right. We will discuss about it. Okay. Yeah. Most metals are found in the combined state. Combined states of what? Like oxides, sulfides, carbonates, and silicates. Correct? Like calcium oxide, copper oxides, right? Copper sulfide, zinc sulfide. Okay. So this time you do not have metallurgy part. It is deleted. But if it was there, we have to study all these oxides, sulfide ore, carbonate ore, and everything. And all this part is very interesting. I hope the guys who are going to give NTSC, they have done that. Right? Okay. Some non-metals are found in the free states, like what? Helium, neon, argon. With these, you can say that all the noble gases are found in the free state. Okay. Some are found in the free and combined state both, like sulfur, phosphorus. So which form of sulfur, what molecular form of sulfur is available free in the free state in the environment? What molecular form of sulfur available in the free? Very good, Aryan, Surya, correct, S8. Okay, sulfur is polyatomic. Acid form of the molecule is available freely, right? And in for phosphorus, only two respond. Seriously. For phosphorus, what is the atomicity of phosphorus? Okay, Aditya, Surya, Mamita, Anirudh. Good. Aryan, yes. P4. Tetraatomic, right? P4. Correct. Good manners. Now we will see some physical properties of metals as well as non-metals. First, physical state. We are very well known with the fact that metals are solid at room temperature, right? Except what? Mercury and gallium. We have discussed melting point of mercury and gallium, right? 1 minute, distant people are coming. 1 minute, yeah. So, except mercury and gallium, correct? These two metals are, mercury is already liquid at room temperature, and gallium, it has very low melting point. Okay, when you put it on your palm, it will get melt. Okay, next, non-metals. Non-metals are generally solid and gases, okay, at room temperature. But bromine is liquid at room temperature. So, only one non-metal we have liquid at room temperature. Okay. Next, melting point and boiling point. Melting point and boiling point for all the metals are usually, they are high, right? Melting point and boiling point, they are very high. Again, except gallium, cesium, correct? But any other examples? There are a few more examples in which you can say that melting point and boiling point is not that high. Yes, iron, potassium and sodium. Correct, potassium and sodium. Okay, correct. Non-metals have all... Okay, wait. Yeah, non-metals have low melting point and low boiling point. Except what? Diamond, right? Diamond, except diamond and graphite. Okay, next, density. Metals, they generally have very high density, and non-metals, they have very low density. Very normal point, very common point. Next, malleability and ductility. Metals are malleable and ductile in nature. But non-metals, they neither malleable nor ductile. Correct? Okay, now here we have discussed a point, right, in a class. 1 gram of gold can be stretched into a thin wire, but yes, 2 kilometer long wire. Very good, Shreyasi, right? 1 gram of gold can be stretched or can be converted into 2 kilometers of a long wire, right? Okay, which property is this? Malleable or ductile? Good. Correct, yes. And which is the most malleable metal? Which is the most malleable metal? Arjun, think, beta. Anirudh, yes. Anirudh, think. Anirudh, Aryan, think. If the silver is the most malleable metal, then why Rutherford has used gold? Right, Ralph, correct. Yes, Aryan, no. Shares, Ralph, Shobita, Sarita, Anirudh. Yes, Aryan, gold, correct. Okay, it's gold because it is the most malleable metal. You can convert it into the thinnest layer, okay? Layer of the metal. That's why Rutherford has used a gold foil in his experiment. Okay, next. What I was doing? Yeah, I was talking about electrical and thermal conductivity now. Yeah, let's move on to this point. Electrical and thermal conductivity. So, metals are very good conductor of heat and electricity. But which metal is a poor conductor of heat and electricity? Manas, gold was correct. Now, which metal is a poor conductor of gold? Very good. Lead, correct. Good. Very good, Aryan. Lead and mercury. Correct. Okay. Lead is very poor conductor of heat also. Okay. Yeah. Next. Non-metals are usually poor conductor of heat and electricity except one thing, graphite. Okay. This is one allotrope of carbon. Okay. Except graphite. Now, metals are luster in nature. Fine. All the metals are luster in nature, we know. But non-metals are... They are not luster in nature. Only iodine, except iodine. See here, all the exceptions are very important. I have told you when we were doing this chapter in the class, right? So please remember or please recall all the exceptions here. Okay. So in metals, in the first point, what we have, metals are solid at room temperature, but exception, except mercury and gallium. Non-metals are solid and gases at room temperature, but bromine is a liquid at room temperature. Melting point, boiling point. Usually for metal, it is very high. Again, we have exceptional cases here. For gallium and cesium, it is low, right? And for sodium and potassium also. One second, something is... Yes, Surya, they are shiny, but they quickly react with atmospheric oxygen. Okay? Yes, right? Next. So sonorous, you know, I have seen a question, I don't know in which year it was, approximately 2017 or 2018 it was, why the ring bells are made up of metal in the schools. It's very, very easy question, isn't it? Because metals are sonorous. They produce sound when they strike with any other metal object, right? Yeah. Okay. Non-metals are not sonorous. Correct. Hardness. Usually metals are very hard except sodium, potassium, cesium. And you can include gold as well. Right? The pure gold is very soft. 24 carat. Okay. Non-metals are what? Non-metals are solid. But they are not very hard. They are brittle in nature. Okay? So solid non-metals, they are not very hard except carbon allotrope, diamond. Diamond is the hardest one, right? Okay, let's talk about the chemical properties. In this, the first we will see reaction with oxygen. Then we will see reaction with water. One second, guys. Yeah. Reaction with oxygen. So sodium, aluminium, all the metals, they react with oxygen to form metal oxides. Metal react with oxygen. Gives what? Metal oxide. MO, I'm writing here. Okay, metal oxide. But that reaction happens or reaction takes place based on reactivity. Especially when you see the reaction with water. Okay, here we will learn the reactivity series. Correct? So, for example, here we have sodium. When sodium reacts with oxygen, it forms sodium oxide. Then when aluminium reacts with oxygen, it forms aluminium oxide. Please write the formula correctly, okay? So, learn, you have to keep, remember the valency of aluminium and oxygen here. So, this is very basic thing, but don't do any mistake here, okay? When aluminium reacts with oxygen, it forms aluminium oxide. When iron react with oxygen, what it will give you? Very good. Fe2O3. Correct. And you know, there is one more formula of iron oxide. Fe3O4. When it will form Fe3O4? When iron can form Fe3O4? Very good, Shreyas. When iron react with water steam. Okay. So, yes, very good. When iron react with steam, water steam, then it gives Fe3O4. Okay. Ferroferric oxide, something like that, the name of this compound, right? Okay. But when iron react with oxygen, it forms Fe2O3. This is the most common formula of iron oxide, right? Most commonly available form of iron oxide. Yeah. Okay. Now, zinc and aluminium form amphoteric oxide. They show the property of both like acid as well as basic oxide. Okay. So most of the metals are oxide and are insoluble in water. Yeah, sorry. Most of the metal oxides are insoluble in water. Some of them dissolve to form alkali. Like what? Like sodium. Sodium oxide, potassium oxide, they dissolve in water immediately to form NaOH, sodium hydroxide, or KOH, potassium oxide will form potassium hydroxide, right? Okay, now let's see reaction of non-metals. Yes, yes, Surya. Only highly reactive metal oxides, highly reactive metals will produce those oxides which will be soluble in water or which will react with water to form hydroxides. Okay, next. Now, we'll see reaction of non-metals with oxygen. Very simple. All non-metals react with oxygen to form non-metallic oxide, right? And you know very well, as metallic oxides are basic in nature, so non-metallic oxides are acidic in nature, correct? We have learned in acid rain also. Carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, they react with water to form what? Sulfuric acid, nitric acid, right? Okay, come back to the point. Now, carbon reacts with oxygen to form carbon dioxide. Similarly, sulfur reacts to form sulfur dioxide. Okay, here carbon monoxide and H2O. Okay, carbon monoxide and HO2O are the natural oxide. Ayo, SO2 actually. Wait, something went wrong here. Arjun, what is your question, beta? Non-metals form amphoteric oxide? No. Arjun, non-metals form always acidic oxides. Non-metals always form acidic oxide. Okay? Some are there which forms neutral oxides. Understood? Guys, just give me a minute. Yeah, sorry. So what we were talking about, yes, non-metal react with oxygen to form acidic oxides. Okay, and I just have told that some non-metallic oxides are neutral oxides. Okay, which are the neutral oxides? Any guess, anything? And shares up. No. Okay. And? COH2O and okay guys, this is fine. You know, there are some more oxides which are neutral oxides. See here I am writing, please make a note of that. Again I have seen a question, but it was in 2011, but still we have to do, right? Okay, so nitrogen monoxide, correct. Andrila, correct. Nitrogen monoxide and dinitrogen oxide. Nitrogen monoxide, dinitrogen oxide, carbon monoxide and water. They are what? They are neutral oxides. Okay? Now, right? And carbon dioxide, silicon dioxide and what should I say? Sulfur dioxide. These are all acidic oxides which we know commonly occurring oxides. Done? But some are forming amphoteric oxides. I will write here. Amphoteric oxides of non-metals. Okay. Any guess? No? It's okay. Arsenic is the non-metal which form amphoteric oxide. There is one more metal. Any other metal if you know? Antimony. Antimony, right? Next. Next, any guess? Which can give you non-metallic, amphoteric oxide? Aluminium, zinc is the beta aluminium. Very good, Aniket. Aluminium and zinc is your metals. We are talking about amphoteric oxides of non-metals. Okay. So germanium. Okay. Good. Done. So now we are done with acidic oxides, amphoteric oxides of non-metal. Okay. Let's go ahead for the next paragraph. Now, carbon monoxide, water, nitrogen monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, these are what? These are neutral oxide, neither acidic nor basic, right? Non-metallic oxides are soluble in water. They dissolve in water to form acids. They dissolve in water to form acid. Please remember, when sulfur dioxide react with water, it forms sulfurous acid. It forms sulfurous acid, okay? SO2, when react with water, it gives H2SO3, not H2SO4. H2SO3 again react with oxygen and then it gives you H2SO4. Okay. Okay. Now we will see reaction with water. Metals react with water to form metal oxides or metal hydroxides and they release hydrogen gas. Correct? For example, when sodium react with water, it gives you sodium oxide, but it's highly unstable. It reacts again with water immediately to form sodium hydroxide. Okay. And what? Hydrogen gas. Okay. Similarly, when potassium reacts with water, it also gives KOH. Okay, KOH. I haven't written the balanced reaction. You please write balanced reaction. Potassium reacts with water to form KOH directly. Okay, again, why? Because potassium oxide is extremely unstable. So these are what? These are highly reactive metals. Now, if we talk about some metals, I don't have space here. Wait for a second. Highly reactive metals like sodium, potassium, they form hydroxides. Plus water, what it gives? Hydroxides. One second, still some people are joining. Yeah. Okay, metal hydroxides. M plus, right? Less reactive metals. Plus water. What do they give? Oxides. Really? They also form hydroxides, but they are moderately reactive metals. Okay? Oxides and then hydroxides. Here I will write reactions. Sodium plus water, it gives NaOH plus hydrogen. So if I balance it, two here, then two here. I hope it is balanced now, right? Iron, wait. I'll come to least reactive metals, okay? Second, potassium plus water, it gives 2KOH plus hydrogen. Fine. Okay. Yes, less reactive metals. You can say less reactive metals are calcium, magnesium. They react with water, but they don't react violently. Okay. So they react with water less violently, I should say. And even, you know, this one, the calcium react less violently. And magnesium even don't react with cold water. We have to heat it. Right? So magnesium do not react with cold water. We have to heat it. And calcium react with water but less violently. So they also form what? Hydroxide. Calcium plus water. It gives calcium hydroxide. And magnesium plus water, it also gives magnesium hydroxide. But hydrogen would be there. Okay, yeah. Okay, now we will talk about the metal which do not react either with cold water or hot water. Okay, let's discuss that. Yes, Shreyas, magnesium will react with water, steam, but not at the room temperature. Steam, it should be very hot, right? Yes. Okay. Next, what we have, the metals like aluminium, zinc, iron, they don't react with cold water or even hot water, they don't react, but they react with what? Water, steam. Aluminium, iron, and zinc. But they react with water, steam. And what does it give to form metal oxide? Metal oxides. Okay. Now let's see, like aluminium. Aluminium react with water. But here I have to mention gas, or you have to write steam. Okay. And it gives aluminium hydroxide, aluminium oxide, Al2O3 plus hydrogen, right? Aluminium 2, if I do 2 here, 6, okay. Then zinc, it's so simple, easiest reaction, right? Zinc oxide plus what? Hydrogen. And the last one is what? Iron. Iron react with water, steam, again, gas. Gas, don't forget to write this, okay? The state you have to mention over there in this is special kind of reactions. Yes, iron react with water vapor and it forms Fe3O4, okay? Plus hydrogen. If I balance it, 3 here, 3 here, 4. Done. Guys, have you written? Okay. Non-metals do not react with water. Non-metals do not react with water, water, steam to evolve hydrogen gas. Okay. Because non-metals cannot give electron to hydrogen ion. Why non-metal cannot react with water? Why non-metal do not react with water? Because they don't have hydrogen. They don't have electron to provide hydrogen. Okay. What will happen after dissociation of water? We will have H plus ion, right? And non-metal cannot share their electron with the H plus ion, right, in water, so that they can't release H2 gas. Okay, that, any question till here? Any question related to the topic? No? Okay. Guys, understood everything? Only few are responding, like Surya, Shreyas, Anirudh, BIPR and Indranagar NPS guys are responding. Okay, so if you got it, you have to say GI, 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 okay? If you have no doubt, then ND, 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 right? Remember all the short words? Okay, next. In the properties, we have reaction with acid and then we have reaction with salt solution. Let's talk about reaction with acid. So a universal formula, metal plus acid gives salt. One second. Excuse me. Metal plus acid give metal salt plus hydrogen gas, right? Okay. Magnesium react with HCl acid. So it forms magnesium chloride and hydrogen gas. When any metal react with sulfuric acid, it gives you sulfate salt. Sulfate salt. When metal react with sulfuric acid, it gives sulfate salt. When metal react with hydrogen chloride, it gives you chloride salt. Okay. When metal react with nitric acid, then what happens when metal react with nitric acid, beta? Yes, then it gives you NO2 gas. Correct. Because HNO3 is a strong oxidizing agent. That's why when metal react with HNO3, hydrogen gas is not produced. Okay? Because metal HNO3 itself is a very strong oxidizing agent. It oxidizes hydrogen gas and it converts into the water. And nitrogen dioxide gas is released. NO2 gas is released. Okay? Yeah? Okay, but we have few metals which react with HNO3 to produce hydrogen. Okay, like what? Manganese. Manganese react with HNO3 to produce manganese nitrate and hydrogen. Yeah, correct, 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 Shobita. Magnesium was also the part of this. Okay, good. So, metal with HNO3, commonly it does not produce hydrogen gas. Why? Because it is, HNO3 is a strong oxidizing agent. Okay, but there are few metals like manganese, magnesium, they can produce hydrogen gas when they react with HNO3. Okay, Aryan, please remind me in the end of this class when we will be solving question. In end, probably I'll try to keep 5 minutes of doubt session. Then just remind me this, okay? Good question, yeah. Aluminium has 3 valency and HNO3 it is going to react with. Okay, we'll see. Okay, now next what we have, reaction with salt solutions. Metal react with a salt solution. These reactions are completely depending upon what? Metal reaction with salt solution depends upon what? Ralph, Anirudh, Aniket, Aryan. Yes, yes. Reactivity. Good. Good, Shaduli. Good. Reaction of a metal with salt solution depends upon what? Reactivity of the metal. So when metal reacts with salt solution, more reactive metal will displace the less reactive metal to form its salt. Correct? For example, copper sulfate. What is the color of copper sulfate? What is the color of, blue. Okay. So copper sulfate blue solution, when we keep a zinc rod into the copper sulfate blue color solution, what happened? The blue color of the solution will disappear in some time. Why? Because the copper will be displaced by zinc and it forms zinc sulfate. Copper will be displaced by zinc. Correct? It forms zinc sulfate and copper. So your blue color solution will turn out into colorless solution. Correct? Okay. After that, we will talk about the reactivity series of metals. Now, next what we have, when non-metals react with salt solution, more reactive non-metal will displace the less reactive non-metal. Correct? The best example what we have of sodium bromide, the aqueous solution of sodium bromide, when react with chlorine, it gives NaCl. Because chlorine is replacing bromine and bromine aqueous solution. Okay. Now I was talking about reactivity series. Okay. So the first element what we have in the reactivity series, potassium, which is available. Okay. Which is available for the reaction. That's what? Potassium. Correct? Next. Next. What should I write after that? After potassium, what do we have? Good, Aditi. Aryan, yes. Okay, sodium. Okay. After that, lithium, iron, yes, that's fine. Yeah, but any other element which we have, which we can see in so many compounds? Lithium compound, we don't use much. So, after sodium, what do we have? Calcium, right? After calcium, magnesium, then aluminium, zinc, chromium, iron, right? Cobalt, nickel, lead, right? Okay, out of these, you can avoid these metals which you are not going to use a lot. I'll just write this one. Okay, iron and then lead, right? This is the metal which are, you can say that they are reactive. They can replace hydrogen. After here, we have hydrogen. After that, what do we have? Copper, mercury, silver, platinum and gold. Very good, Aryan. Correct. AU. Good. Okay. So this is the reactivity series of metals. Done? Okay. Next, what we have, reaction with, again, we are talking about the reaction with salt solution. So when the metal react with salt solution, the more reactive metal will displace the less reactive metal, that we understood. I have repeated this. Leave it. Next, reaction with chlorine. Why we are learning reaction with chlorine? Because it gives us the most common compound which we use in to form more other important chemicals. Right, in the chemical industries, this is what common salt. So reaction of metal with chlorine, metal react with chlorine to form metal chloride, and the another thing is what, it forms ionic compound. It forms ionic compound. When metal and chlorine react, they form ionic compound. Okay, what is the name of that ionic compound? NaCl. Very simple, right? Okay, can anybody just give me the definition of ionic compound here? You, if you want, you can unmute and talk to me. You can just tell me. Anybody? good, correct, very good. Compound formed by transfer of electron, right? And compound formed by sharing of electron is what? Covalent compound. Good. Compound formed by transfer of electron is known as ionic compound. Yes, correct, correct, Aryan. Compound formed by transfer of electron or exchange of electron, same thing, right? Okay, good. Then, okay, now let's talk about the reaction of chlorine with nonmetals. Nonmetals reaction with chlorine. So you know what? Chlorine is also a nonmetal itself, right? When nonmetal react, they will form covalent compound. Covalent compound formed by sharing of electrons. Sharing of what? Electron. And here exchange of electron, right? Okay, good. Next, what we have? Reaction with hydrogen. Reaction with hydrogen. Metal react with hydrogen to form metal hydride, right? And in this reaction takes place only for the most reactive metals. Okay, you know why? Because the metal should be more electropositive than hydrogen, right? See here, the hydrogen oxidation number is -1 and +1 for sodium. So hydrogen is available in the negative oxidation state. Hydrogen is accepting electron, right? Okay, nonmetals, when nonmetals react with hydrogen, they form hydrides. Like when hydrogen reacts with sulfur, it forms H2S, right? H2S gas. Okay. Now we'll talk about the properties of ionic compound. And here only we will discuss the properties of covalent compound as well. Guys, just give me a second. Okay, let's continue. First thing, the physical state of ionic compound. Ionic compounds are solid and hard due to the strong forces of attraction, right? They are usually brittle in nature. Fine. Melting point and boiling point. They have very high melting point and boiling point because of strong ionic forces of attraction. Guys, I am receiving your messages a little late. Okay. Okay, next. Solubility. Ionic compounds are soluble in water and insoluble in organic solvents. What is the meaning of organic solvents? Organic solvents like what? Petrol, diesel, kerosene, hydrocarbons. These are what? Hydrocarbons. Okay, they are insoluble in hydrocarbons. Why they are insoluble in hydrocarbons? Because they are polar in nature and water is polar in nature. So polar will be soluble. Polar will be soluble into the polar solvent, right? Like dissolve. Got it? Guys, got it? What's happening? Are you feeling sleepy? Seems only Surya, Aryan, Shardali, and if you are attending the class. Athira, where are you? Athira, Disha, you're also not responding. Hi, Pratiksha, you're also there in the class. But are you actually there? Hi, Vaibhav is there. Vasundhara is there. Tavishi, Surya is responding. Fine. Shriram, you're also not responding. Sneha, you just have joined. She's joining. Hope I'm pronouncing it right. Sakshi is also not responding. Hi, Ria, Ria. Ralph is responding in between. Ria, where are you, beta? Are you understanding? Hi, Rakshit. Prishim, hello. Where are you? Are you there in the class, beta? Hi, Pratik, Pranav. Didn't see any message from you guys. Hi, Navya. Navya, you're also not responding, beta. What's happening? Momita, yes, Momita, you were responding, but suddenly then you vanished. Huh? Manas is responding. Laksh, hello. Laksh, am I audible to you? Are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Kiranmay, Karthik, Aryan, then we have Arundhati, Arjun, Aryan Tandon is responding. Aryan Singhal is also responding. Avni, hello Avni. Ganesh, just show your presence, beta. Yes, Laksh. I think I heard some sound. Maybe it was you only. Okay, let's continue. So guys, please let me feel, yeah, like I'm teaching to you guys. Okay, it should not be like I'm just teaching to three people here in front of me. Okay, everybody should respond. Just talk to me. If you have any doubt, you can discuss here. You at least you can post your doubt here. So I'll just explain in the end of the class. Yes, Shardulia, I'll explain the polar solvent. Polar solvent means which can dissociate into ions. Which can dissociate into ions. Okay. Okay, next what we have, conduction of electricity. Ionic compound, they conduct electricity, but in liquid state. Okay, ionic compound in solid state does not conduct electricity. Ionic compounds in liquid state only can conduct electricity. So Arjun, actually when you have very high reactive metal and the moderate reactive metals, like what? Like I should say sodium, potassium, calcium and magnesium. Okay, these are highly reactive metals. These are moderately reactive metals. Okay, they will form hydroxides. These will form dihydroxide and these will form monohydroxide. Correct? Apart from other metals, they will form oxides. Apart from these metal, other metal will form oxides. Okay, guys, there was a question Arjun asked. Oh, seriously, I'm not receiving all the messages. I'm receiving just few messages. One second. Let me just check what is the issue. Guys, please give me a minute, okay? Okay. Oh, okay. Arjun, no, beta. It's like as I explained here, the highly reactive metals like sodium, potassium, they are definitely going to form hydroxide. Okay, they form monohydroxide. And then calcium and magnesium, they are moderate reactive metals, or you can say less reactive metals. They form hydroxides. They also form hydroxides, okay? Except these metals, other metals which are you can say least reactive metals with water, okay? They form or they don't react with even water, they form oxides. Yeah, I think Ralph, did you ask a question about the conduction of heat or something? Raj, so actually I didn't understand your question. Could you repeat? Okay, fine. Okay, so Ralph asked a question related to conduction of heat, but I didn't understand the question. Metals are usually a good conductor of electricity and heat, okay? When we were talking about the metals, but we discussed that lead is a poor conductor of heat and electricity, okay? Lead is a poor conductor of heat, okay? Now, here we were talking about conduction of electricity. Ionic compound, they are good conductor of electricity when they dissolve in water. Okay, solid compounds are not the good conductor of electricity. Why? Because they don't have free electrons to move, or they don't have space for electrons to move. Okay, and same thing is applicable for conduction of heat as well. Okay, right? They don't conduct heat because they don't have free electrons, or they don't have a space for free electrons to move. Next. Reason again, the ionic compound, why they don't conduct electricity in the solid state. Ions cannot move due to the rigid solid structure. Okay. So, the ionic compound conduct electricity only in the molten state. Now, what is the reason why they conduct electricity in the molten state? Their ions can move freely. Okay, why? Because in the electrostatic forces of attraction between the oppositely charged ion is overcome due to the heat, right? Okay, next. Now, some noble metals like gold, silver, platinum, they retain their luster because they don't react with atmospheric oxygen, atmospheric moisture, and acids. Okay. So, these three metals, they don't react with air, water, or acid. So, they are called noble metals. Right. Gold dissolves in aqua regia. This we have discussed in acid and bases also. Aqua regia is what? It is a mixture of concentrated nitric acid and hydrochloric acid. Okay. I have learned in the way of HCl is to HNO3. 3:1. Okay. So whatever you feel comfortable. HNO3 is to HCl. 1:3. Okay. How will you remember that this is the ratio, like 1:3? I have learned in the way of HCl. There are three letters. H, C, and L. So 3 should be here. Okay. Then obviously 1 will be with HNO3. Right? Hope this help. Okay. Next, what we have? 24 karat gold. Okay. Pure gold is what? It is known as 24 karat gold. It is very soft. Okay. We can't form ornaments with this pure gold because it's soft, right? We need little bit harder thing to just make ornaments. So what we do? So we mix some other compounds, some other metals, like what? Silver, copper, to make it hard. Okay. So why 24 karat gold cannot be converted into ornaments, or why we can't use it as to form ornaments? Because it is very soft. And what we have to do to make ornaments with this, we have to add some silver or copper into it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Next, what we have? Uses of metals. Arin, you just have asked a question. What is the composition of 22 karat gold? Good question. 22 karat gold means 22 part of gold will be mixed with 2 parts of some other metals, like maybe copper, maybe zinc also sometimes they mix. Okay. So 22 part of gold and then 2 part of copper and zinc. Okay. Okay, guys, one question. It's just a general discussion, not the related to this thing. What is the meaning of this 24 karat gold? Like, how much the percentage of gold is there? If I say 24 karat gold, what is the percentage? And if I say 22 karat gold, then what is the percentage? Yeah, I know 22% is somewhere approximately 92% or 91%. Okay, somewhere it is 91%, 91.6%. Okay, but I don't know about 24 karat. Anirudh, Aniket, any idea, any guess? Manas, any guess? What is the percentage of 24 karat gold? I think it's 91.6 something, or you can say 92, but 92.5, I'm not so sure. Oh, really? Google says 99.9%. All right, nice then. Okay, so 24 karat gold is, yes, she has 24 is the most pure form of the gold. Yes, so 24 is 99.9% and 22 is 92%, you can say. 92% for the safer side. Okay. Okay, guys, come back to the point. Today also we have so many questions. Yeah, see? I'll show you the questions. Oh, quickly, let's finish. Yeah, uses of metals. Iron is used for making pin, nails, nuts, bowls, so many things, you know, right? Aluminium we use to make utensils, wire, aluminium foil, parts of aircraft because it is very light in weight, okay? Vehicles, machines, we use in packing of food. Why? Because it has the property to protect the food from the oxidation, right? How? Because aluminium upper layer react with the oxygen and it form aluminium oxide layer so that it can protect the food from oxidation, right? Okay, next what we have, copper. Copper we use for making wires, vessels and electrical gadgets, correct? Next, gold. Gold we use for jewelry, coins, medals also, yeah. Silver. Silver again we use for jewelry, coins and medals, right? Platinum. Platinum again we use for jewelry, electrical gadgets, plugs in some vehicles, okay? Now sodium. Sodium we use as a common salt and we use to make other chemicals in the chemical industries, right? We have learned in acid and bases. Okay, next, calcium. Calcium we use for making of cement, marbles, right? Glass, okay? Next, now we will see some uses of non-metals. Now I'm going little fast, because we have to finish so many things. I'm not receiving any of your message, okay? So if I'm not responding of your messages, then be patient. Okay, now uses of non-metals. Sulfur. Sulfur we use for making sulfuric acid, salt. Salt of metals, okay? Salt of what? Metals. Oxygen. Oxygen we use for obviously respiration by the living things. It is used for the respiration by living things. And in the chemical industry, we use for the oxidation process or burning of the fuel. Okay. Nitrogen. Nitrogen we use to make ammonia. Very, very important compound like common salt. Because if we use this ammonia to form fertilizers. Yes, Aryan, correct, good. Next, hydrogen. Hydrogen we use to make, to form ammonia. Again, we use this ammonia to form fertilizers. Hydrogen we use as a fuel in rockets. And hydrogen we use also as a welding purpose. Okay, so the uses of hydrogen is very important. First, the preparation of ammonia, then the preparation of fertilizer because of the ammonia, then use as a fuel. Because it reacts with oxygen and it gives energy. Then hydrogen we use in the welding purpose. Okay. Next we have chlorine. Chlorine we use to kill germs. In what? For purification of water. Actually not purification of water, for cleaning of water, right? Next, iodine. Iodine we use as a tincture iodine. Tincture iodine is what? The mixture of alcohol and iodine, right? This is an antiseptic. Okay, done. Next. I don't think you guys have alloys, but just have a look, okay? Because it's not clearly mentioned that it is deleted from your portion. So alloys, alloy, the definition you know very well, the mixture of two or more metals. Okay, the mixture of two or more metals is known as alloy. They are not chemically reacted with each other. The metals are not chemically reacted with each other in this in the formation of alloy. So first alloy, what we have? Steel. Steel is a mixture of iron and carbon, correct? You know the uses of steel. Okay, then what we have? Stainless steel. Stainless steel is a mixture of iron and chromium, and some part of nickel is also there, but it's okay, you can avoid it. Next, we have brass, then bronze. Bronze is a mixture of copper and zinc. Bronze is a mixture of copper and tin. Okay, don't get confused. Brass, copper and zinc, bronze, copper and tin. Okay, brass we use for utensil, for handicraft, and for musical instruments. And bronze we use for statues, medals, bell, okay, and ornaments. Okay, next what we have? Alnico. Alnico. I didn't hear much about it. Have you guys? No? Okay. Alnico is a mixture of iron, aluminium, nickel and cobalt. This we use to make magnet. Next what we have? Duralium. One second guys. I have received your messages. Aryan, correct here. Actually, you're right. Aluminium, nickel, and cobalt. Yes. Okay, next what we have? Duralium. Actually, it should be duralumine. Okay, it should be duralumine. Yes, this is the combination, or this is the mixture of what? Aluminium, copper, manganese and magnesium. This we use to make utensils, pressure cooker, part of some vehicle and in aircraft. Okay, you please learn this one. I don't know why I'm feeling that this one is little different. So maybe this is important, right? Alnico we use to make magnets. And the composition is iron, aluminium, nickel and cobalt. So Alnico, aluminium, nickel and cobalt is here. You just need to learn iron. Why? Because we used to make it magnet. Okay, next. Corrosion is not there. I know. Don't worry. But still, just have a look, okay? The surface of some metal gets corroded when they expose to moist air for a long time. Okay, this is called corrosion. Now, preventions from the corrosion, we can apply oil or grease on the metal surface, or we can apply paint. I love to do some DIYs and all those things. So I use this technique a lot to prevent corrosion for my metal objects. Most easiest one I feel, right? Okay, next, galvanization. Galvanization, that means what? Coating of another metal, okay? With a non-corrosive metal like zinc, okay? Next, what we have? Electroplating. Electroplating is again the same process, coating of metal with a non-corrosive metal like chromium by passing electricity, right? Okay, next what we have? Alloying, by formation of alloy, correct? That's how iron we can use to form, to prepare utensils and all. We use iron alloy to prepare utensils and all, right? Okay, next what we have? Okay, now let's start doing this question. So here you guys have four questions, okay? You have to answer me for this. 1 minute. Okay, first you answer me for three questions. Aluminium is used for making cooking utensils. Which of the following property of aluminium are responsible for the same? Tell me. Yes, Aryan, we can do anodizing as well. This is the process mentioned in somewhere in the book. I have seen, yeah. First answer I have got from Shreyas Mamita. Shrijani, yeah, sorry, Shrijani. And Anirudh. Okay, only four, seriously. Guys, we are 54. Yes, so the first answer, correct answer is what? D. Okay, the aluminium property, first and fourth, good thermal conductivity and high melting point. Yes, the second, most abundant metal in the earth crust. Most abundant metal in the earth crust. Quickly, guys, fast. Maybe I guess I am not receiving your answers. B. Guys, it's B. Okay, aluminium. This is the most abundant metal. Aluminium. Okay. Next. Hansa, Mana is not responding. What's happening? Jankiram, are you there or not? Not responding. Vishwat, Shobita, Momita, yes, responding. Okay. Okay, the next what we have, poorest conductor of heat among metal. It's A. Ralph, it's A beta. Okay, correct, yes. A, the poorest conductor of metal. I was telling you when we did this, right? It is lead, PB, poorest conductor of heat. Okay, next question. Which property of metal is used making bells? Aryan, it was not ductility beta. Check your answer once again. Yeah, correct. Now it's correct. It's A, sonorousness. Okay, metals are sonorous. That's why we use to make bells and all. Good guys. Next. Aluminium oxide react with sodium hydroxide to form what? It's like I'm not getting your messages or what? Suddenly I got. Anirudh, I didn't understand your question. Strings, which is strings? Yes, Shobita, 5C, correct. Good, very good. Yes, 5 is C, correct answer. Sodium aluminate. Yes, the name of this salt is what? Sodium aluminate. Okay. Six answer. So many of you have answered me. Six answer. Which of the following is the correct arrangement of the given metal ascending order of their reactivity? It's D, guys, right? Sodium, magnesium, zinc, and iron. Done? Okay, which of the following oxides of iron would be obtained on prolonged reaction of iron with steam? Easy question. Yes, it's clearly C, okay? Don't get confused with the D option. Actually, D is not possible, yeah. Don't get confused with the B option, I should say. Yeah, it's C. Then 10th one, which of the following is not ionic compound? Very good. B, correct. HCl is the covalent compound and CCl4 has highest covalent characteristics in available or easily available compounds. Okay. CCl4. This, I should say that highest covalent characters in this compound we have. Okay. The most abundant or easily available compound. Okay. Yes. The electronic configuration of three elements XYZ. Which two elements will combine to form an ionic compound? Okay, some of you. Only three answers. Seriously, yaar, matlab. It's B only, because Y is 2. And Z is 2, 7 and Z is 1. Okay, so 2, 7. Y is your 2, 7. It needs one electron. And Z is your 2, 1. It can lose one electron. Correct. So YZ. Actually, don't you think that the name should be Z and Y? Isn't it? Am I right, Anirudh? What do you say? See here, this is the electronic configuration of non-metal. This is the electronic configuration of metal. Right? So metal should come first now. Cation comes first, anion goes after that, right? So Z, Y it should be. But it's okay, it doesn't matter. This is the possible compound we have. Yes, next. The highly reactive metals like sodium, potassium, magnesium, etc. are extracted by, so you don't have extraction processes. You can leave this question. I didn't see that. Okay, avoid this question. Please ignore. Next, we'll do 13th one. Which of the following is non-metal? Which of the following non-metal is lustrous? It's simple. Easy question. Na? D. Iodine. Example of amphoteric oxide. Good. Aluminium oxide and zinc oxide. These are amphoteric oxide. Then here we have aluminium oxide. Okay. 15th one. Which of the following is an acidic oxide? This is also easy now. Carbon dioxide, is it? Let me check. Right? Correct. 15th one is C. Okay. Which of the following is the acidic oxide? So carbon dioxide is the acidic oxide. Yes, Arjun, correct. Aditi, correct. Correct. Yes. The atomic number of the element X is 12. Which inert gas is the nearest to the X? Nice. Good. Yes. C is the correct. Neon is the inert nearest inert gas. Really? Nah. What is the atomic number of argon? And neon? 10. Okay, correct. Then it's correct. Okay, next. Good. The process in which carbonate ore is heated. This is not there in your portion. You can ignore this. Next. Yes, oxides of moderately reactive metals like zinc, iron, nickel, tin, copper, etc. are reduced by using which? Yes, this is a tricky question. Do this. 18th question. Okay, I'll tell you this, okay? See, you know what? Oxides of the moderately reactive metals like zinc, iron, nickel, copper, these can be reduced by carbon. Carbon serves a good purpose of good reducing agent for these type of oxides. It will take oxygen from there and it will form carbon dioxide. Okay, let's say zinc oxide you have, and if we react, yes, aluminum is also a sort of good reducing agent, but before that we prefer carbon because it's cheaper than aluminum. Aniket, so yes, we have to go to the more appropriate answer, right? Yeah. Okay, zinc oxide react with coke or carbon and it pulls all the oxygen from zinc oxide and leaves zinc behind. Okay, though this question is from extraction process or metallurgy process, but it's important for you also. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Aluminium is also we use for a reducing agent for this purpose, but it is slightly expensive than carbon. Okay, next. 19th question. In thermite welding, it is not there in your portion. Okay, 20th is not there in your portion, but you have to answer me for this. Tell me, galvanization is the method of protecting iron from rusting by coating with thin layer of what? In galvanization, what do we do? Very good. Good, Arjun, Hansa, Aditi, Shijuni, Shobita, yes, are incorrect. Zinc, okay, in galvanization process we use zinc. Now 21, an element X is a soft and can be cut with a knife. Oh, so simple. Even Aru will be able to answer for this. He has heard so many times about these metals and non-metals and all those things. Yes, good. Next, 22nd question. Reaction between X and Y form a compound Z. X loses electron and Y gains electron. Which of the following property is not shown by Z? Very good, correct, B. Okay, because it is an ionic compound. Z is what, ionic compound? So it cannot have low melting point, yeah. It will have high melting point, high boiling point, right? Next. Okay, the electronic configuration of three elements, X, Y, and Z are this. Which of the following is correct? Correct, Hansa Momita, for the previous question. Okay, answers are coming. Yes, guys. Right. Jankiram, your answer. Ralph, where are you? Answer for this question is D, copper and zinc. Correct. Oh, amalgam of alloy. No, I went wrong. Sorry. Answer for the previous question is D. Y is non-metal and Z is the metal. Okay, yes, amalgam of alloy. Amalgam is an alloy of mercury. It's B, right? Correct, everyone. Yes, Anirudh Surya, correct. Next. Okay, see, this is the question. Here now, we are doing questions from past year. Maybe past year sample paper, past year board exam papers. Okay, so we'll see how to write the answers or what are the keywords should be there. State the reason of following. Aluminium oxide is called as an amphoteric oxide. So aluminium oxide react with acid as well as a base. That's why it is an amphoteric oxide. Simple, right? This is the long answer, 5-marker question. So simply you should write what? It is an amphoteric oxide because it reacts with acid as well as base. Okay, next. An iron strip dip into a blue copper sulfate solution. Turn the blue solution to pale green. What is the reason of that? Because iron react with blue color of copper sulfate solution, right? Because iron can displace copper from its solution, and it will produce iron 2 sulfate. Okay, iron 2 sulfate, which has pale green color. Right? Next, hydrogen gas is not evolved when the most metal react with nitric acid. We have learned it, right? Because the necessary hydrogen is produced further, which further react with HNO3. Okay? To reduce it into N2O, nitrous oxide, NO, nitrogen monoxide, or nitric oxide, or NO2, nitrogen dioxide. Okay? Another reason you could write here that nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. Okay? Hence, it can't produce hydrogen gas. Got it? Next question. Calcium does not occur in free state in nature. Why? Because calcium is what? Highly reactive metal. Okay? So it combines with gases of the air. Okay? That's why it's available in the form of calcium carbonate or sometimes calcium hydroxide or calcium oxide. Next, sodium and potassium metals are kept under kerosene. Very old question, right? When I was in 10th grade now, since that time I am learning this question. Sodium and potassium metals are always kept under kerosene because they are highly reactive, right? They are most reactive metals. They react with oxygen and moisture of the air. The reaction is highly exothermic. That means it produces a huge amount of heat, and the hydrogen gas evolved can catch fire. Thus, it is very explosive, right? Hence, they are kept under kerosene oil to just avoid their contact with air. Okay, next question. List the tabular form of three chemical properties on the basis of which metals and non-metals are differentiated. You just tell me any one property. Second question you don't need to write because it is from metallurgy, and this was the question of 2018. You can leave this question, okay? But yes, you tell me any one chemical property which you can say that, okay, metals and non-metals are different. Are you, tell me one chemical property. R. No. Aryan is saying something here. Good. Yes. Very good. Correct. Yes. So here, this was 3-marker question actually. I'm just giving you 4 or 5 options what you can write in the exam. Okay. Property here, metal and non-metals. Nature of ions. Nature of ions. Okay. Metals are what? Electropositive. I'm writing in short here because we don't have enough time. We have so many questions today. Okay. So metals are electropositive. Non-metals are what? Electronegative. Correct? They form electronegative ions. Right? Nature of their oxides. So metal forms basic oxides. And usually non-metal forms what? Acidic oxides. Right? Right now I'm not able to see your messages, so please don't send any message right now. Okay. Okay. Water, Aryan, as Aryan said, that reaction with water. Reaction with water. Guys, I'm using short forms here, but you can't use in your exam. You don't get marks for that. Okay. You're going to lose your marks if you use these kind of short forms. Okay. So please be careful. reaction with water. So what happens? Metals react with water and it displaces the hydrogen from water. Metal displaces hydrogen from water. And non-metal cannot. Non-metal cannot displace hydrogen from water. So they don't react with water, right? Okay, next. We can say that nature of chlorides, right? Nature of chlorides. So when metal forms chlorides, just learn the best example, NaCl, it forms ionic compound. The metal chlorides compounds are known as ionic compounds, but non-metal chloride compounds are covalent compound, correct? CCl4, covalent. So I'll just write here NaCl and CCl4. Okay, next question. What is the reactivity series and how does the reactivity series of the metal helps in predicting the relative activity of various metals? Obtaining metals from the oxide. Okay, this is from your extraction. You can avoid this. Now this question is easy. What is the reactivity series? You know what is a reactivity series, right? And how does a metal can predict the reactivity? No response. Okay, I'll write it here. Okay, so the metal can be arranged in the order of decreasing reactivity in the series. Metals can be arranged in the order of, very good Aryan, of decreasing reactivity in a series. Okay, this series is usually known as what? Reactivity series. It's called reactivity series of metals. Okay, now the second part, how does the reactivity series of metal helps in predicting the relative activity of various metals? So you know what? The chemical activities. Ideally, now when you start the next part, you should write from the next paragraph. So it is clearly visible. Chemical reactivity of metals is linked with their relative position, is linked with their relative position. In what? In activity series. So the metal placed at higher in the series is more reactive. Okay, so a metal placed higher in the series is more reactive as compared to metal which is occupied the lower position. Okay, metal which occupy a lower position, right? Okay, next question. How will you show experimentally the metals are good conductor of heat? Okay, this question is going to come in another few slides, so we will see. I have written already the answer. Okay, it will save our time. Okay, now this was from sample paper of 2019. Oh, okay. Next we have question from 2015, two markers. Write one example of each. A metal which is so soft and it can be cut with knife. So you all are aware, right? Which metal is very soft and which can? Got one answer? Okay. Ralph, gold. And what about sodium and potassium, Ralph? Yeah, sodium, potassium, gold, anything is fine. Okay. You just have to write names. Okay. Not this Na and K. Sodium, potassium, gold, Au also is fine. Okay. A metal and a non-metal which exists as a liquid at room temperature. So answer for the first one was that. And for the second one is what? Mercury. And mercury is the metal and non-metal is what? Bromine. Right. Br2. Correct. Next. Mention the name of the metal for the following. Two metal which are alloyed with iron to make stainless steel. Answer. Good, Ananya. Ralph, good. Correct. Answer for the second main. Two metals which are alloyed to form iron to make stainless steel. I guess chromium and nickel. Am I right? Good. Guys, it should be chromium and nickel. While going through the table only, I told that to make stainless steel, we use chromium as well as nickel. The proportion of nickel is less, but still we use it. Okay? Yeah? Two metals which are used to make jewelry. Ah, simple. Silver, gold, platinum. But here I'm writing their symbol. You can't write symbols. Good, Ralph. Very good. In the exam, you can't write symbols. You have to write the full name. Okay. Next, 2015, three marks. State three reasons of the following. Sulfur is a non-metal. Magnesium is a metal. And you know what? The one reason should be written in a chemical reaction or chemical equation way. So see here, I'm writing sulfur is a non-metal and magnesium is a metal. So sulfur is a non-metal and magnesium is a metal. Okay. Now the first is what? Sulfur is poor conductor of heat and electricity. Poor conductor of heat and electricity. You know, right? All the non-metals are poor conductor of heat and electricity except diamond. Diamond is a good conductor of electricity. Then magnesium is a good conductor of heat and electricity. My handwriting is very bad now. Indira Nagar people knows very well, right? Very good. Iron form covalent compound and then they form Ionic compound. Okay. Think. Is magnesium oxide ionic? Beta, if you want to say covalent compound or ionic compound, then you have to take the support of chloride salt. Okay. Magnesium oxide is covalent, polar covalent compound. Okay. Okay. So sulfur. So second property we will write the physical property, malleability. Sulfur neither malleable nor ductile. Nor ductile. And magnesium is what? Malleable and ductile. Okay. Magnesium is malleable and ductile. Next, the last property based on the chemical equation. So, first thing you can say the reaction with chloride, what Aryan told, right? Ionic compound and covalent compound. Another thing you can say with oxides, okay? Using oxides example is better, right? So when sulfur react with oxygen, it forms what? Sulfur dioxide. And this sulfur dioxide is acidic oxide. How will you prove that this is acidic oxide? So you have to write another reaction. SO2 react with water and it form H2SO3. H2SO3. Please be careful while writing this. Again, I'm saying, okay, this is acidic oxide. Oxide, and you have proved it, like you have given example why it is acidic oxide. It forms sulfurous acid. Okay, now let's talk about magnesium. Magnesium, when react with oxygen, it forms magnesium oxide, which wait for a second, guys. MgO2, which react with water, and it forms magnesium hydroxide. So this is what? Basic oxide, right? Yes. Moving to the next question. Write the electron dot structure of potassium and chlorine. So potassium, first we will write it for potassium. What is the electronic atomic number of potassium? Good. Okay. So what should be the electronic configuration? 2, 8, 8, 1. So electron dot structure. That means what? The structure with only valence shell electron. Dot structure. That means the structure with only valence shell electron. What should be the structure? Potassium. And how many valence electron do we have? Only one. So that's it. Right. Next, chlorine. Cl. Atomic number is 17. Electronic configuration is 2 at 7. How many valence electron do we have? 7. Correct. So how will we represent it in the dots? Cl. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. Right? Got it? Now, second part they are asking, show the formation of KCl by transfer of electrons. Show the formation of KCl by transfer of electrons. Simple. So potassium will lose one electron to form potassium ion. And chlorine gains one electron to form chlorine negative ion. Okay. Right. So now this potassium, one electron will go with what? Chlorine's electron, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It will come here. okay, and it gives you K plus Cl minus combination, or you can say that KCl. Done. Now the next question is what? Name of the ions present in the compound KCl. You potassium positive and chlorine negative, chloride ion, potassium ion and chloride ion. Simple. So what do you have to write? KCl has these two ions. Okay. K plus and Cl negative. Okay. Next question. State the electron dot structure of calcium and sulfur. What is the atomic number of calcium? Tell me fast. Okay, Aryan, Shreyas, Shrijani. Only three people. Seriously, we are 50. Arjun, correct. Navya, Shobita, Momita, Anirudh, where are you guys? Sharon, Manas, Aditi, correct. 20. So, calcium 20. Its configuration should be 2, 8, 8, 2. The dot structure will have calcium 2, right? 1 and 2. Good, Anirudh. Good, you have mentioned electronic configuration as well. Now, guys, tell me electronic configuration of chlorine. Sulfur, not chlorine. Sulfur, atomic number and electronic configuration. Okay, correct. Yes. Aniket, Shreyas, Aryan, Tandan, Momita, Anirudh, Ananya, good. Correct. So 286. That means its atomic number is 16. Its configuration should be 2, 8 and 6. How many valence electrons do we have? 6. So how will you represent it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right? Good. Good, Arjun. Okay. Next, what we have? Show the formation of CaS, calcium. What should be the name of this, beta? Write down the name of this compound, CaS. What is the name of this compound? Write it carefully. Don't get confused in between sulfite and sulfate. Very good, Shes. Correct, Aryan. Calcium sulfite. Okay, when we have only S now, then we say sulfite. So the formation of calcium sulfide. Is calcium loses two electrons to form calcium 2 plus. Okay. Sulfur gains two electrons to form sulfur 2 minus. Right. Now see what's happening. Calcium is losing two electrons to sulfur. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here these two electrons are coming. See. Right. And that's how it gives you Ca2 plus. I don't have a space at the bottom, so I'm writing here, okay? In right hand side, Ca2 plus S2 minus, or you can write here CaS, okay? Now, the name of the ions present in the compound CaS is Ca2 plus. Plus S2 minus. Okay. Not actually plus S2 minus. C2 plus and S2 minus. Yeah. I think I have mentioned it wrong. It is not from 2015. Okay. The year I don't remember. I forgot. Okay. Next. Now the seventh question you guys try by your own at home. Okay. Write the electron dot structure of chlorine and calcium. Okay. Then you have to show the formation of calcium chloride by transfer of electrons. So how you have to show? Like this. This is important part. this one is also okay. After that, what is there? Identify the nature of above compound and explain the physical property of such compounds. So we'll do this part, B part. Identify the nature of this compound. What is the compound? Calcium and chlorine. The compound would be what? Calcium chloride. What will be the nature of this compound? Very good. It is ionic. Calcium chloride. It is ionic. Okay. It is a ionic compound. Okay. Explain three physical properties of such compounds. Shreyas, ma'am, why are there some chlorides like it? Good question, Shreyas. Abhi, I'll just explain you in short, okay? Because we don't have so much of time. But if we will have time in the end, then I'll explain you in detail. So, why few chlorides like HCl and HCl are covalent? Because there is not a big electronegativity difference in hydrogen and chlorine, okay? As compared to calcium and chlorine, if we use calcium and chlorine or potassium and chlorine, they have a big electronegativity difference. Okay. That makes it ionic compound. That makes their compound ionic. Okay. How come lower element beta? No. Hydrogen is on the top. No, when you go top to bottom, electropositivity increases. Electropositivity increases, right? Okay, so when you go top to bottom, more electropositive compound you will have. And chlorine is electronegative, correct? So the electronegativity and electronegativity difference will increase when you go top to bottom, right? No. Then Shreyas, you can't relate it with the reactivity series. Here you have to relate it with the periodic table. Reactivity series will only give you the information about the speed of the reaction or which can react faster. Yeah, the speed of the reaction. Okay. Reactivity series won't give you information about electropositivity or negativity thing. Okay. Yes, chalo. So the answer what you can write for this question is the electronegativity difference in between hydrogen and chlorine is not as much as calcium and chlorine. Hence, HCl is covalent and calcium chloride is ionic. Okay, next what we were doing. Yes, identify the nature. Yes, so we were talking about three properties. First, physical properties. First, physical property. It is hard and solid. Second, it has high melting point and boiling point. It has high melting point and boiling point. And last, it is soluble in water. It is soluble in water. Okay, done. Next question. You are given with the sample of three metals like sodium, magnesium, and copper. Suggest any two activity which arrange them in the order of their decreasing activity. So we will see activity. For these three metals, the first activity very good, Aryan. The crystal structure also could be a point for physical properties in the previous question. Correct, Aryan. Good. All three points are absolutely right. Very good. So fast, huh? Your typing speed is too good. First activity. Sodium react with cold water vigorously. React with cold water vigorously. to form sodium hydroxide? And hydrogen gas. Magnesium does not react with cold water. Magnesium does not react with cold water. But with hot water, it will form magnesium hydroxide. But it reacts with hot water to form magnesium hydroxide. I think I should write a reaction as well, right? I forgot. Sodium react with H2O and it gives NaOH plus hydrogen gas. Next reaction, magnesium react with water to form MgOH twice plus H2. Okay, this would be aqueous and this is obviously gas, correct? If you don't write the states now, that is fine. Okay, no need. It's your choice. Here it is 2. It should be, yeah, it's balanced now, correct? Which compound do we have next? Copper. Copper does not react with cold water, right? Even in the hot water also. Copper does not react with cold water or hot water. Done. Next activity. Next activity we can use for displacement reaction. Okay. So here, with the help of this activity, you can say that sodium is more reactive than magnesium and magnesium is more reactive than copper. Done. Let me just see if I have space here. Ayo, I don't have space. Okay, next I'll write here activity 2. You can use displacement reaction. Magnesium react with SO4 to give magnesium sulfate plus copper, and copper does not react with magnesium sulfate. Okay, so here no reaction. Shares, you can say the reaction with oxygen, but you know, it is very difficult to identify the rate of reaction for oxygen, like for your grade. Okay. All the reaction react in the same manner, almost similar manner. So the rate of reaction, you need some other instrument to identify rate of reaction. Yeah, it's better to write the easy things. Water is very easy thing, right? You can observe simply by the visual inspection. And the displacement reaction is fine. Color change will tell you everything, right? Okay. Okay, guys. So let me just check how many questions are there more. Okay, so time is now up. We have few more questions like from 2014, 2013, and I guess 12. Okay. And I will upload this presentation in Moxtra group, but in that presentation, all the answers will be there. All the answers, whatever we have done, like this question answer also will be there. Okay. So the presentation which I'm going to upload in Learnist, in that comprehensive revision group folder. Okay. You will find all the answers. Please go through this whenever you have time or whenever it is comfortable for you. Okay. Okay, guys. So any doubt, any question? Great. Okay. Only Arun is responding. Where are you? Ananya. Finally, Ananya has came after that. Okay, fine. So, how was the class? Huh? Very less responses today. Acid and bases were more interesting, I found. Is it? What's happening? Rishita, you were not at all responding. You haven't answered for any of the questions. Aryan Singhal, where are you? Okay, guys, good. Okay, enjoy your day and all the best for NTSC exam, which is going to be on this Sunday. And maybe, I think Sunday or Monday, I'm not sure. And all the best for your final exam also. Okay? Chalo, okay, guys, all of you, bye. Aryan, I think you were asking something about some HNO3 and some reaction. I'll just try that now, okay? HNO3 plus aluminium. Is it visible to you, Aryan? So you were talking about the balanced equation of this. This will give you first aluminum nitrate, NO3 thrice, and water and nitrogen monoxide. So now if I balance it, nitrogen here we have 3. And 4, so it should be 4. Hydrogen is 4 here. Now we have 2, so it should be 2. Check, Aryan, is it balanced now? Welcome, guys. Bye, beta. Bye. Take care. Enjoy. Bye, bye. Aryan, is it okay? See, is it balanced now? Okay, good. Chalo. Bye, bye, bacha. Bye. Thank you. Bye, bye, bye.